Rogue, one of the reasons it's become so popular is that it's a natural counter to the Paladin deck. Paladin, in about just a month ago in the metagame, it was one of the top two most popular decks, I would have to say. But Rogue deals with it so well because the Paladin doesn't put enough pressure on the Rogue, and the Rogue can just swing back so hard every single time. In addition, one of the best cards of Paladin, which is Muster for Battle, gets countered so easily with one of the best cards from Rogue, the Fan of Knives.
Yeah, not only that, but you get to buy so much tempo with your hero power. You're investing 2 mana and 2 points of life into opposing 4 potential mana of your opponents. So every single time that you have a dagger up, they're very reluctant to make a token if they can otherwise do something. And with the Paladin development, like you said, the cards are not the greatest cards in the world against Rogue. Muster for Battle gets countered by Fan of Knives. Shielded Minibot is vulnerable to Backstab and SI7 Agent. It's really just got all the tools necessary to line up perfectly against what Paladin tries to do.
Mm-hmm. You can see Lothar kind of sporting kind of a new look in this tournament, in this final grand final match. On day one, he went with the cowboy look. On day two, he went with like the classic Lothar look. But now he's changing it up even more with the dirty cone look, I'd have to say.
Yeah, this is your wizard, Lothar.
I actually asked him about this look online, and he said it's a reference to Rincewind. I've never heard of it, but I'm sure you guys can look that up.
I'm going to Google it afterwards and find out exactly what he's talking about.
Yeah, I Googled it, and it's basically like a guy in a wizard hat.
Is he playing real-life Hearthstone? Look at those cards. I want a couple copies of those.
And just a word, we actually have $500 additional dollars to Child's Play, and who donated that? It's none other than Kinguin. So if you want to support them and support charity, donate to Child's Play. Or just look at all the great Kinguin games you can see right below us right now on the stream.
Yeah, great stuff. Crushing that goal, dominating it. I want to see it destroyed. Muster for Battle is going to come out here. Lothar doesn't actually have access to Fan of Knives this turn. So he's going to have to be kind of carefully treading through this water. I mean, Quartermaster and Coin are both available for Life Coach next turn. So if he doesn't clear up some of these minions, he could be in a little bit of trouble. I think I would like to see him use Backstab and SI7 Agent here. And then he's going to have the dagger to actually take care of the third token, so wouldn't be the biggest threat in the world. And he just needs to get stuff on the board. Like, throwing away the backstab, it kind of sucks, but you got to do what you got to do sometimes. I can also see Violet Teacher and backstab just to kind of get some tokens rolling, but that's going to get his Violet Teacher checked. So both of these lines, I think, are totally reasonable. The only thing I don't think is reasonable would just be playing Earthen Ring Farseer on this empty board.
Yeah, that just feels way not aggressive enough. Also, one thing that Lothar has to consider is if he knows Life Coach's deck very well, then he knows he only is going to have one Quartermaster in this deck, which is less likely to be played on turn four. Unfortunately for him, though, Quartermaster is in Life Coach's hand right now, so we might just be seeing an easy trade into the Violet Teacher, and then the Blight's Justice running into the Violet Teacher token.
Yeah, I think he's pretty unhappy to trade both of these minions in to the Violet Teacher, but this is a minion that needs to be checked.
Mm-hmm. An alternative is just to equip the Truceover, and then you're going to have more alternatives to play the Quartermaster in later turns, and also you're going to save your coin.
Yeah, right now he's wishing he could attack the Violet Aprinus, equip another weapon, and then attack the Violet Teacher. But unfortunately, you can't attack twice with weapons unless they have Wind Fury.
One thing I like about the Truceover play is that it sets up, if your opponent, for example, plays Azure Drake next turn, you get a free Truceover kill. Plus, if you play the Truceover right now, I guess, you're going to have a problem actually playing anything on turn 5. So that's definitely also a consideration. Something we didn't consider
You know, I actually really like this line, and there's two major reasons why. The first one is it helps him keep tokens on the board. The second one is he has two equality in his hand, so burning the first one isn't that big of a deal. The third one is this uses his mana most efficiently. And then the fourth one is this still threatens Quartermaster on this board. So Lothar, he still doesn't have a very efficient way to clear this stuff as far as Life Coach's perspective is concerned. He's got a 3-point dagger, and he just used a backstab.
Wow, this actually looks so good right now. Lothar didn't have much to clear the tokens, and now this is going to be a much better Quartermaster turn than last time, so Light Coach actually sets that up really well. The real question in here is, which Silverhand Recruit does he trade into the Earthen Ring Farseer?
You got to trade the normal one. You got to keep the gold on the board.
All right. You got to bling out your opponent,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he needs that white and gold token on the board right now.
White and gold? Yeah. I see blue and black.
Well, you're looking at the SI7 agent then.
All right.
Yeah.
I see that as white and gold too. Am I going crazy?
Hashtag team white and gold.
All right, so I guess Lothar's entire hand will be, well, almost his entire hand will be used right now. And Lothar just needs to draw a print fairly fast, or Life Coach will actually be able to outvalue him. This is not a common thing for Paladins to do at all.
Yeah, looking for Sprint, looking for Azure Drake, and two True Silver Champions available for Life Coach right now. But I think he's going to use this last charge of True Silver Champion. Before of the Life Justice, before he uses it to use True Silver Champion.
I kind of really want to favor getting the True Silver Champion up, though. It's one of your stronger cards against Rogue, since a lot of their minions are just either 3 health or 4 health.
Quartermaster being a 2-3 instead of a 3-3 is really, really hurting right now.
This is also one of the problems with Life Coach's, I guess, higher curving deck. If you don't draw your higher curving minions, then you just don't have a lot of threats. I think the only threats that that Lothar is running are like the piloted Trenners, the pilot Sky Golems. I guess now that I think of it, there are a lot of threats, and I guess Lothar or Life Coach is just a bit unlucky not drawing any of them right now.
Yeah, he got a good quartermaster turn, but he's really drawn all of his responding stuff instead of anything really worthwhile. So he's basically just going to have to give up this quartermaster. I think he's going to leave his opponent with a 3-1 on the board. So this draw is really important to Lothar. You actually saw just Life Coach shake his head there. And Blood Mage, not too good right now, but not the worst. It is going to put a threat on the board that, again, is very inefficiently dealt with by Life Coach. And these one health minions, this has really been, in my experience, the story of Control Paladin struggling. Like, this is the sort of thing it struggles against, is having one health minions having initiative on the board.
Mm-hmm. You would think that Paladin would be able to deal with it with Muster for Battle, but after one has been used, it's just so difficult putting aggression onto the board when you don't have any silver can recruits. Fortunately for Life Coach, though, Dr. Boom was drawn, so why not just Dr. Boom on turn 7?
Yeah, the problem with this, though, is that he still needs to deal with his 3-1. Like, he's staring down a Blood Mage, he's staring down a Dagger. Like, something like a Backstab would just answer Dr. Boom straight away. Even something like a Viscerate without a combo would answer the Dr. Boom straight away. With what's on the board, and since this Earthen Ring Farseer has already gotten value, and since Blood Mage will pretty much always get value, I feel like he's almost reluctant to play Dr. Boom simply because it doesn't really curve into what's happening very well.
I think he's still fine with playing Dr. Boom, though. He's traded so efficiently, and he's gotten so many value trades already with the Muster for Battle, the Quartermaster, and his True Silver Champion that I think he can afford to not play as efficiently this turn.
Yep.
He goes up with another heads-up play, silencing the Blood Mage.
Yep, he's just trying to deny cards from his opponent right now. He's so close to having them almost choked out of the game, and it's very clear that they're kind of desperate for cards, that he is going to do everything to try to answer this. And again, this is sort of a testament to how inefficiently that Paladin has to play against these one health minions when it loses initiative, and that's got to be one of the worst draws in Lothar's deck. That's going to be instantly checked by this True Silver Champion, and now a very clean Dr. Boom turn for Life Coach.
Oh man, Lothar healing up to 26 damage against all that burst of the Paladin, right? I'm just kidding. No burst of the Paladin. Paladin doesn't have any burst.
It's got about 6 points of burst. True Silver Consecrate, man.
Oh man.
That's rocking it. It's only 8 mana to get that damage.
Yeah, and then some rank 13 players are going to go on the ladder, and they're going to get Avenging Wrath, and they're like, Monk and Admirable lied to us.
I'm going to play Spectral Tiger, and I'm going to Blessing and Kings it, and then I'm going to Blessing and Might it, and then I'm going to Blessed Champion it. What do you think of that burst?
Oh, man. I can't even calculate how, but that must be over 9,000 burst.
It's just over 9,000, too.
So, attack, hero power.
Yeah, not the greatest Rogue turn 9, I would say. And Life Coach, oh, geez, he's going to be thrilled to the teeth. Gets to lay on hands up to 30, has 7 cards and a coin to Lothar's 4 cards. This is a crushing... this is a crushing hold on this game that Life Coach has right now. I do not see him losing control of this.
Yeah, Lothar was even reluctant to sap the previous turn, which would have just given him his opponent more Boombots. Violent Teacher, I think, is all right. It certainly won't bring him back in this game, but besides a sprint, it might have just been one of his better draws.
I think he's going to have to sap this turn, I think. Just really no other plays.
There we go.
So I'm gonna backstab. Where's the spoon bot hit? Go straight to the token.
Okay, not bad, I would say.
Just gonna hope that this doesn't hit his Violet Teacher for a million. Hits it for four.
That's a million.
That is a million right now, for sure.
Wow, actually, Sap is not going to go down.
Yeah, so he's going to choose to take seven more damage here. And I think Life Coach is more than happy with that. I think you're going to see Consecration and Sky Pilot Sky Golem join the ranks here. Yeah, this is about the fastest Life Coach turn you're ever going to see. Seven more to face.
Could you actually consider doing that burst combo damage from Paladin, which is the Consecration Truce Over, instead?
You could do that. That might actually be a little bit better, but I still think I'd like to see Piloted Sky. The only way Piloted Sky Golem is going to backfire here is if Lothar kills it, it gets a Piloted Shredder, and then he kills the Piloted Shredder, and it gets a Doomsayer.
Oh, wow. Well. Can Lothar even do that with three cards?
He can. I mean, he's got a three-point dagger out right now. I mean, these three cards aren't going to do it, or these two cards aren't going to help him do that, but...
I think at this point, Life Coach is like, do I want like a 99.99% win rate or 99.999% win rate in this game?
He's going to figure out which one of those lines it is to make sure that he gets the job done. So I said it was going to be one of the fastest Life Coach turns you've ever seen, but I lied to you. There's no such thing as a fast Life Coach turn. He's going to go choose Silver Champion. He's done the math. He's figured it out. He's a scientist. He did lose 2 points of healing value here, though, and that's going to be crucial.
So Lothar, right now, he's going to need to sap, and he's going to need an Earthering Farseer, pretty much. Edwin Van Cleef is not an Earthering Farseer, so he's going to get a big Van Cleef, I guess, and that's going to be game.
Yeah, important to make it a 4-4 here to try to tempt Life Coach to attack into it with the True Silver Champion. Maybe save himself. That's a misclick sap on that 1-1. You can see Lothar is visibly upset by that misclick. Game one, going to be going over to Life Coach in this one. Paladin, pulling off a win with Paladin against Rogue has got to feel pretty good.
Yeah, especially since Paladin has been one of your weaker decks in the tournament, I feel. Paladin, before this, it was the deck that had the least win rate and the first 2 days combined, something at around a 22% win rate, going a combined total of 2-7. Normally, Rogue is extremely favored in the matchup, but I have to feel that this Muster for Battle just gained so much more value than it normally does against Rogue. We didn't see a fan of knives, and we didn't even see any board clears being used to effectively deal with that the 3-1-1s on the field.
Yeah, we didn't see fan of knives, we didn't see Azure Drake, we didn't see Sprint, and all of those card draw effects are pretty crucial to the Rogue strategy. And just, I mean, when you don't see them draw any of them, they are going to fall behind in cards because they're trying to invest cards into gaining tempo and then keeping up in cards by using everything else. So just when you don't have any of those tools, you will find Rogue oftentimes just kind of peter out and really not have anything to do.
Yeah, and now Life Coach with his Paladin, I would say, judging from recent results, the weakest deck of the three. He's left with Druid, very strong, considered to be one of the top decks by everyone. He's left with the Handlock, a deck he's extremely comfortable with, and he's left with the Mech Mage, a deck that just doesn't lose sometimes, you know. It just gets wins off, it gets the Antoninus off, it gets Fireballs, lots of spare parts, and, you know, just closes out the game.
Yeah, Mech Mage really kind of one of the defining decks of the format, really dictating a lot of how people choose to build their decks because they need to answer things like Mech Warper. They need to be able to handle the early onslaught and also stay out of reach of what Mage has in the last few turns between Fireball and Frostbolt. So with these lineups happening, I think Life Coach is going to go with Warlock here.
Warlock. Yeah, I think Warlock has been like the go-to deck for Life Coach throughout this entire tournament. But no, instead, Life Coach will be going for the Mech Mage.
All right, so Mage is going to be queued up here. And Lothar's Hunter deck, remember, we saw RDUs earlier. It was sort of a mid-range deck that wanted to scale into big threats. Lothar is dedicated to going straight for the face here. And I think Face Hunter versus Mech Mage is definitely going to favor Face Hunter in this matchup.
We saw Lothar put out a fairly convincing win against RDU's Mechmage. Let's see if he can repeat the performance against Lifecoach. And just looking at the opening hand right now, I have to say that his opening hand is one of the best you can hope for as Face Hunter. You have your perfect turn one play, the Leper Note, plus you have a Glaive Zuka, which I happen to believe is one of the best cards you can draw against an aggressive deck like Mechmage. Against more control decks, it just gets two damage into the face often, but against against very low curving decks that have Cogmaster and Mech Warper, it can just get consecutive value trading over and over again. Sometimes, and it's sometimes even better than a Fiery War Axe.
Yeah, it definitely can be because of the plus one attacking can provide to a minion. And Wolf Rider going to be added into this, so all of Lothar's hand is very hero powerable by this mage, but again, the only thing he's looking to do is put more pressure on his opponent than his opponent can put onto him. And the very first draw from Lifecoach's mirror entity, and Dr. Boom was one of his replacements, he actually chose to mulligan Mad Scientist in this matchup, and I have to say I'm a little bit surprised by that.
Mm-hmm. One other card that he decided to keep was the Goblin Blast Mage, and that's not a card I would expect many players to keep, especially because he doesn't have a mech in hand. But I think Lifecoach's rationale is that against a board such as Mass Unleash the Hounds or Mass 1-1s, Goblin Blast Mage is just so impactful. But unfortunately, Lothar, he's going to curve out so well, and Lifecoach might not even get a mech on the field by the crucial turn 4.
Yeah, I suspect that hero power is very likely to be used here.
Yeah, I would suspect as well. There's
what to do? What to
if you play a Mech Warper on the field, you just instantly get blown out by Glaive Zuka. And indeed, Lifecoach does go with the ping.
Yeah, unless he would have chosen to trade in his Cogmaster and the Leopard Note, that would be the only time that he wouldn't get blown out by Glaive Zuka.
Glaive Zuka is certainly a play right now. You kind of use it as a mini Fiery War Axe, but Fiery War Axe is just so good in this matchup that even if you don't play for a full value War Axe, then this 2-1 attack weapon from the Hunter is still very valuable.
So Mechwarper going to come online, and Lothar has kind of an answer to it if he wants to answer it, but again, this deck is more about pressure to your opponent than it is about answering things. But we saw in the first few stages of the game, Lothar was tending to try to find a spot where he could eventually get a favorable board position. And I think Mad Scientist is going to be his best attempt at this. Like, if Lifecoach doesn't have a proper response to this, Mad Scientist threatens so much damage in the form of Explosive Trap. And when you couple that with Unleash the Hounds, he can basically clean the entire board up, and then weaving in hero powers gets such a massive advantage on board from that Lifecoach would have to have so many strong responses to get past it.
So Lifecoach, he kept Goblin Blast Mage in his opening hand, and I'd have to think he really wants to use it on turn 4. But this board is kind of a bit awkward to use it on. There's a small chance that the Mad Scientist doesn't die, and if it doesn't die, it's going to get so much Explosive Trap value. Or perhaps Misdirection value, right?
Yep, so he's going to play Goblin Blast Mage after attacking. He doesn't want to run into Explosive Trap just yet, and he knows that Misdirection's available, so let's see what that one is. That one's going to be Explosive Trap, but we do know that Lothar's got Misdirection in his deck. Something to look out for. And now, this is a spot I think that Lothar was trying to, or hoping to avoid, and what Lifecoach was trying to create with Goblin Blast Mage. He knows he's playing against Face Hunter, so he just wants to put out a mid-sized, very efficient threat, and something like Goblin Blast Mage is perfect for that job.
You know what's actually interesting about Goblin Blast Mage? It's not really relevant in this match, but the Goblin Blast Mage just trades so well against Sludge Belcher that it's kind of like an anti-Sludge Belcher card, and one of the reasons the Blast Mage is so good. I think it might even be better as a 5-4 than a 4-5.
Yeah, I think so as well. I think 5-4 is just exactly what that card wants to be. By any deck that's favoring aggression, I would say that it's mid-size drops. You want them to be healthy enough to withstand stuff like Wrath and Dark Bomb, but you want them to be strong enough that, again, they can run over stuff like Sludge Belcher. You don't have to invest extra mana into doing something about it.
Well, Wolf Rider is actually going to be the play.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and set up very obvious telegraph of Explosive Trap, but he's got to do something to make sure he gets value out of it.
Mm. Yeah, just overall, very defensive play altogether. these mirror entities are some of the worst cards that Life Coach could draw. Not only do you not get value from the mad scientists, but your opponent is going to have so many small minions. This Hunter deck is just full of the small minions that mirror entity just isn't valuable at all. And I think that might be one of the reasons why he didn't keep mad scientists in his opening hand.
Yeah, I would tend to agree with you. That being said, I still think there is a small advantage right now to Life Coach. He does have mirror entity in Annoyatron after this explosive trap gets popped. So he will have more of a board presence, I think, than Lothar will have. And then he gets this scale into Dr. Boom on turn 7. So if Lothar can't find some pretty important pressure very soon, he's going to find himself just falling way behind. Something like Knife Juggler. Like, say Life Coach chooses not to attack this turn because he doesn't want to proc explosive trap. Something like Knife Juggler would be one of Lothar's best draws.
Yeah, and not only Knife Juggler, but if you mirror entity a minion, then you get a minion. So that's one additional hound your opponent can summon. So that might be the mirror entity might actually hurt you in certain situations.
Yeah, so just gonna go ahead and go Annoyatron mirror entity, and I think this is enough of a board setup that it does pose a threat to Lothar. Tracking comes into hand. This is a card that's basically been extinct for for quite a while now. And I think one of the reasons why is because when you run Mad Scientists, early on you ran four traps because of the Eaglehorn Bows, and now that's not the case anymore. Now you run like two traps. So when you tracking and you burn over one of your traps, what ends up happening is that Mad Scientist value can often go way down. So I think that's why that card has kind of fallen out of favor.
Mm. He's going to have, I guess, a decently hard decision, but I think you do go with the bow right here. The misdirection, if you're going to have to use for... Like, the Mech Mage is always going to have minions on the board that do one or two damage, so I don't think the misdirection is the best right here. But I guess in aggro versus aggro, every point matters. Still, the bow in order to get board advantage is just definitely a keeper.
Yeah, I think this is just going to Hero Power and Haunted Creeper. And then continue to bide your time. He may want to Iron Beak Owl because he knows that he's facing down a mirror entity. That's also a possibility. So, I mean, this is really kind of affecting how the next couple of turns develop. But I still think I'd like to see him play Haunted Creeper.
One other thing you have to consider is what in the deck can you owl, right? What actually does Mech Mage have that you can owl? I guess the best is Piloted Shredder.
I think Annoyatron's probably one of the best ones. It's a card you don't really want to have to kill. Mad Scientist is okay, but again, two mirror entities are already gone at this point, so Mad Scientist is, I mean, that's just a 2-2. Life Coach has drawn three. Like, after you draw mirror entities, Mad Scientists are the worst draws in your deck. And when you draw Mad Scientist, mirror entities are some of the worst card draws in your deck. So a little bit of anti-synergy involved with these two cards. And his play just has, I mean, he's really just no action this turn.
I still think Life Coach is at a pretty decent shape right now, just because he's at 26 HP. And against the Phase Hunter, you're just always scared of your health. He also has the Dr. Boom on turn 7, which is more value out of one card than Lothar can get out of his individual one cards. So this game might actually not turn into a race. In fact, we're looking at it, it's not a race at all right here, and it might just go into the value wars.
Yeah, that's kind of the exact position that Phase Hunter doesn't want to be in as well. It races very well. What it doesn't do is trade super efficiently and scale into the late game. So definitely, I think, an advantage over the Life Coach, despite the fact that he has no action this turn.
Time runs out on me.
Or no real action. He's got Mad Scientist, he's got Mirror Entity, but you know, putting two power minions on the board on turn 6 is not like a very good turn.
Now, we've seen other Hunters deal with Dr. Boom fairly easily with Hunter's Mark, but I don't believe, because this Hunter runs double Iron Beak Owl, I don't believe Hunter's Mark is actually in this deck, so...
Yeah, that's really crazy to me. He's really valuing this Annoyatron a lot right now. And Lothar's starting to count his damage up.
Lothar still doesn't have that Knife Juggler, that key card that he needs.
Yeah, his opponent's also at 26, so he doesn't really have... He's not even really close to having reach right now.
Oh, man.
Life Coach looking to just apply more pressure. Then Lothar can in the next few turns. Life Coach is going to be the one to initiate this race. And I think that spells bad news for Lothar.
Yeah, none of the cards in Lothar's hand right now get that much value. I guess you do Iron Beak Owl the Annoyatron. And then you might run in your
He's going to Abusive Sergeant, run into the Haunted Creeper, and then unleash the Hounds afterwards, I think.
Okay.
That's what it looks like. He's trying to get the most tokens out of this. But then where does he put... I think he should just put the tokens in the face, too.
I think you might put most of them into face, but I think you can't afford to put one into the L. You do want to race, though. Like, the only thing you're scared of by putting a lot of stuff into face... Oh, he's not going to put stuff into face.
Yeah, he
might be just scared of Goblin Blast Mage, but you've already seen one Goblin Blast Mage for your opponent, so it's very unlikely that your opponent still has a mech in hand plus the Goblin Blast Mage.
All right, so that's the fastest turn you're ever going to see from Life Coach.
Of course, it's a Dr. Boom. Right?
Lothar, you know, he's got to feel a little bit bad that he used that that Unleash the Hounds here, but he's actually answering this Dr. Boom pretty efficiently, and Hero Power, it might be enough to start kind of turning the tables here. So Boombot's going to take out another one of these tokens here. I got to feel like he should be favoring face damage a lot more. Wow, he's attacking the other Boombot. So he's doing that to protect this Arcane Golem. So really his bread and butter from this turn is he wanted to clear everything down and get repetitive damage from this Arcane Golem. And with a Goblin Blast Mage, he might not get it. That is a fantastic draw from Life Coach right now.
Yeah, if these Blast Mage shots hit, or even if one hits, that's the best draw in his deck. Everything hits, and I think this might just be game over.
Yeah, I think that was just nail in the coffin. Lothar tried to fight down and get repetitive damage to the Arcane Golem. He was so close to doing it. Really, it was just that one draw. If he had not drawn that Goblin Blast Mage, and instead you would have seen this Animal Companion happen, like, Lothar actually would have had a pretty big advantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if something like another... like a Cogmaster, any low drop came onto the field, something that couldn't deal with the Arcane Golem, Lothar would have been able to kind of race his opponent, getting that 4 repetitive damage every single turn. But as we see now, it's very close to lethal on the board.
7-8 damage. Piloted Sky Golem gets added to that. I don't think there's a single combination of cards. I mean, Lothar could draw like 3 cards right now and still don't have a way to end this game. So Life Coach, he's going to be taking a 2-0 lead here. There's just nothing that's going to end up mattering from Lothar's deck right now. His curve basically caps out at 3. So.
The Knife Juggler just a bit too late. He needed to combo with the Unleash the Hounds about 3 or 4 turns ago. And Lothar is going to give up this game as well.
Yeah, maybe the hat's not working for him so much. I think I would like to see him stick to the cowboy hat. Mm-hmm. That was the one that really felt like it was pulling the most weight for him. So.
You know, I think in that game, or just overall in general, Life Coach is one of those players where we try to predict his plays and... We can predict usually most of the other players' plays, but Life Coach just has such different lines from, I think, every other player in the game. He's kind of like a Strife Crow in that sense, where he kind of sees beyond what's on the board.
Yeah, definitely takes a lot of interesting... One of the things that I think is hardest to predict from him is how he chooses to mulligan stuff, because I see him keep cards so often that end up having an impact, but have such a big risk to not have an impact in the game. Like, keeping the Goblin Blast Mage, he pitched back 2 cards... And he kept his Cogmaster, so he has 1, 2, 3, 4. He had basically 5 draws to fight it back, which isn't the worst case scenario in the world. And I think it's something that not only me, but a lot of players in general haven't experimented with enough, is keeping cards that you feel like are super important in matchups and really looking for big swing turns. Because it doesn't have to work, frankly, if it fails 30% of the time, that means it's working 70% of the time. And I don't know what the exact numbers are, but I'm sure he has some sort of thought in his head and has done some sort of math to kind of get to a point where he knows that keeping Goblin Blast Mage does have a risk associated with it, but that the payoff is so high that it's worth it.
At least in that game, we saw that keeping Goblin Blast Mage in his opening hand really paid off. He got a really good Goblin Blast Mage on turn 4, the exact time that you want to play the Blast Mage, and he had a very threatening 5 attack creature on the board. Lothar had to play defensively from that, and I think that's when the game really swung around. Not only that, keeping the first Goblin Blast Mage allowed him to draw the second Blast Mage even more, so getting the second Blast Mage out really swung the game. The Blast Mage is just an example of a card that is just so impactful in that in this particular matchup. It's almost even like a Harrison Jones or a Black Knight.
Yeah, in a lot of situations it is. It's sort of like the mage version of Implosion is what's happening. So Lothar still all 4 decks available to him, and Life Coach with Warlock and Druid left. What does Lothar queue up against this combination to make sure he gets something done? I think I still like Face Hunter.
Yeah, I would have to say Face Hunter probably does very well against both those decks. Druid, they have to run a lot of taunts, and even if they run a lot of taunts, you have your double Iron Beak Owl against Handlock. Well, Handlock's just going to have a really bad time. I think Phase Hunter versus Handlock, one of the more lopsided matchups in the entire game, if they don't get something like Ancient Watcher into Iron Beak Owl on turns one and two.
Yeah, or have Sledge Belchers to back it up and things like that. You're not running two copies of Iron Beak, I'm sorry, of Hunter's Mark anymore, and you don't quite draw quite as many cards with stuff like Starving Buzzard, so there are some big swing turns available. But I would tend to say it favors Face Hunter, not quite as much as it used to, but another card that really affects that is Misdirection. One of the reasons why Handlock, I think, has done so well versus Face Hunter is because Face Hunter doesn't run Misdirections anymore. But Lothar's got one copy of it in here. It could really shake things up if he's looking to, like, say he gets kind of low early on and he initiates a race with Molten Giant and a Taunt. The Molten Giant can very easily backfire in certain situations.
Yeah, exactly. And I think the game is about to begin. Nope, not yet.
Just waiting for the players to be ready and hop into the game. So I think that Life Coach is going to go with Warlock here. But I just really don't see another option from Lothar other than Hunter to try to get a win on the board. I think he's really just looking to get a little bit of a mindset back into it and some more confidence. Game three is about to get underway, and we have predicted Life Coach wrong in pretty much every single account so far. So really going, I don't really know how he's making these decisions or what's factoring into it, accounting for. I don't think it really matters which one of these he queues up with too terribly much, because you have to win a game with every single one of your decks. And that's something that Conquest actually does really interestingly, is that the first game, how the matchups line up matter a lot. And then the rest of them, though, it matters less and less, because you're looking for a very favorable first matchup to take the lead in the series and then rely on the percentages to get you there. Unlike in last year of standing, where every single matchup was so terribly important, because if your good matchup got picked off at first, this match would very often snowball out of control.
Yeah, and again, because in the Conquest format, you can never predict what your opponent is going to play on the very next deck, you have to build all your decks with the idea that you could face anything. Decks are going to be well more rounded, and we're going to see a lot more even matchups. Speaking of even matchups, usually this matchup, Mech Mage versus Druid, is tended to favor the Mech Mage, but we've actually seen in this format a lot of different swings coming from Druid and coming from Mage. It could be anyone's game, especially because of the Innervate and Keeper of the Grove. Oh, he actually threw back Keeper of the Grove. That really surprises me.
I'm not too terribly surprised by it, because Keeper of the Grove in this matchup doesn't really hit a lot of targets. It does hit Mad Scientist, but Keeper of the Groving something like a Clockwork Gnome or a Cogmaster is just not a very good feeling. You're really looking for more action. Stuff like Shade of Next Realm, stuff like Druid of the Claw, I feel like has much higher impact than something like Keeper of the Grove does. It really only affects Mad Scientist, even though that's an extremely important card to be fighting against.
Mm-hmm. Life Coach went with a Innervate Shade play on turn one. That's going to leave him very open to just drawing dead on the next few turns, but it allows him to kind of contest the board slightly more. Lothar, he sees this play. He knows it's very likely that Life Coach doesn't have a turn two play, so he'll very likely be hero powering. So I expect something like a coin into one of his two drops right now.
Yeah. Did he keep that Clockwork Gnome in hand, or did he mulligan it?
I think he kept it, actually.
Yeah. Going first, I think that keeping Clockwork Gnome is extremely good, and I think going second, I would tend to mulligan it and really look for stuff like Mad Scientist, Snowchucker, Mech Warper, these problematic two drop minions that Druid really only has one answer to, which is Wrath something, and the other quote unquote answer to it is to have an Innervate in a big turn going into it. Oh. Counterspell gets drawn. Lothar's draws have been so terrible in this final.
Lothar actually gives a huge sigh, and we speculated that Lothar was running three secrets in his deck, the two Mirror Entity and the one Counterspell, but it's entirely possible that he's only running two, and he's just replacing the second Mirror Entity with the Counterspell. If that's the case, the Mad Scientist is just a 2-2. And I'm sure we'll find out what comes out of the Mad Scientist. If it's nothing, it's indeed two secrets, and Lothar is in just not a great position.
Yeah, this is looking pretty rough. I mean, his hand just kind of has no action here. Another big problem with drawing this Counterspell is it looked like he wanted to set Mirror Entity on turn three, which is going to open up Mad Scientist to getting attacked in the following turns. When that happens, he doesn't get a Counterspell from that anymore. He doesn't get anything. So if he does have another copy of Mirror Entity, I suspect he will be dropping Counterspell first. And if he drops Mirror Entity first, I would kind of go with the read we just had, not only in his body language, but kind of how he's trimmed this deck apart. He would only have one Mirror Entity in that instance. That being said, I'm pretty sure that we've seen two Mirror Entities from him. I can't be 100% positive, but I'm pretty sure there's been two Mirror Entities in here.
So Life Coach's decision to intervene at the Shade is, it's not going that well for him, I have to say. Even though I think it was the correct play, now he's drawn kind of dead for two turns in a row. Life Coach's decision also to run such a high curving deck might also be coming to haunt him now. We see Pilot Sky Golem being drawn, and it's Life Coach won't even have a turn four play. On the other side of the coin, though, Lothar isn't drawing too well either. He might just have to play one of his secrets on this turn.
Yeah, I suspect that's what's going to have to happen. What if he drops the mirror into the and attacks and gets another secret? How surprised would you be then?
Wait.
Wow.
Whoa.
So he does only have two secrets in his deck then. He has one copy of Mirror Entity and one copy of Counterspell.
Well, I can see why Lothar's body language was like that when he gave such a huge sigh when he drew his second secret.
It looked like he tried to play the Mirror Entity so quickly that it looked like the mad scientist fetched a secret. And you can see Life Coach, he's kind of looking, he's like, wait, what just happened? He spent 3 mana on nothing?
He's so confused right now.
I think that was Lothar's plan. Look at Lothar. He's kind of looking at the screen like, did anyone catch me? Did the caster see it? Is chat going to know? Oh, geez, I didn't miss lethal, did I? I must
save Life Coach might be thinking that there's a bug right now.
So 2 damage to face, and he sees that it's Mirror Entity. So that was a pretty great draw, I think, for Life Coach. This is actually one of the best ways to counter it, is empty board and throwing Keeper of the Grove into here. And Lothar, he picks up something that's going to be a little bit of action, but just not going to be quite enough. He's going to throw a Hero Power and Keeper of the Grove. Start to chip away at that body and put a little bit to face, but Life Coach's hand is really sacked, and Mirror Entity has already been checked. So all of the tempo advantages that Lothar is looking for in a matchup like this have basically been lost already.
The counter spell that Lothar is running is kind of not doing too well right now. Against Druid, Mirror Entity is one of the best cards in your deck, and by cutting one in favor of counter spell, it's just not doing that much work right now.
Yeah, Life Coach chooses to charge Druid of the Claw into the freeze minion here, and I actually don't like that he chose the freeze minion for it, because it is going to open him up to stuff like these kinds of pings. What I did like, though, is that he chose to charge Druid of the Claw. So when he charges at the 2-3 freeze, what he's trying to do is he's trying to shut off the potential for mechs being there. So I can understand his mindset going into it, but he actually loses an attack with Druid of the Claw when he chooses to play it this way.
I'm actually really surprised that Life Coach just threw down the piloted Sky Golem without a second thought. And what that tells me is that he might actually know that Lothar is playing only one Mirror Entity.
Yeah, I think so as well. I mean, it was so very confident, and that's something you rarely see from Life Coach, is very quick, decisive confidence. But that it being Counterspell actually is really important here, though, because it's going to shut off Wrath. So normally this would be a great turn to just play Azure Drake and then Wrath, Goblin, Blast Mage for 4, and then put 6 points of damage in your opponent's face. But he knows it's Counterspell. And you could tell he knew it's Counterspell, not only because he scouted this deck, but because he's Lothar's teammate, and because he just super confidently checked it with a Pilot Sky Golem. So he's going to have to make this trade first and then evaluate his board state.
What?
Whoa!
Whoa!
That could be really good right now, but it could also be really bad.
You do, if you don't play anything right now, which I think you probably should, you guarantee a kill on your opponent's Keeper of the Grove. On the other side of the coin, though, your opponent has way more mechs than you do. I mean, you're probably only running 2 piloted Shredders and maybe another piloted Sky Golem. Besides that, if that minion is left alive, then it's going to be doing potentially 2 damage to each of your own minions or even yourself every single turn. Can the Fel Cannon actually hit heroes?
It's only minions. I actually want to see him drop Lothab here. And the reason I want to see him drop Lothab is because if Fel Cannon actually hits his own Drake here, Lothar isn't free to just attack the Keeper of the Grove and leave it there. He would actually have to check it with 2 points of mana.
So,
Life Coach gets the right roll, though, and Lothar, you can see just nothing going right for him in this series so far.
Yeah, both players in the beginning of the game, they drew pretty poorly, but the way the hands turned out, because both players drew poorly, both hands were slow, Life Coach is actually favorable in that position because it's up to the mech mage to put initiative onto the field. It's up to the mech mage to aggro your opponent down and force him to respond. And because no player put initiative on the board, and now Druid is just has so much to, going for him. He has such a high curve right now.
Yep, so he's just going to drop down Señor del Fuego to get the job done. Velcannon has two targets right now, and they're both life coaches. So Ragnaros is going to bite the dust this next turn, I imagine, to this fireball. But just really nothing going for Lothar outside of that. He has ways to kind of deal with what's on the board now, but his hand is two spare parts and a Tinkertown Technician. And the Archmage Antonitis, like, he didn't have the early pressure to use that to sway the game like we've seen in so many other Mech Mage games so far this week.
Oh, man. Is Lothar actually playing the control game against the Druid? I mean, it's kind of fair because you do have the Archmage Antonitis, but at this point, Lothar might be overvaluing the Archmage Antonitis right now. On the other hand, though, it might be a fair point that what else can Lothar do? There's a Ragnaros on the board, and it will kill you in just a few turns.
Yeah, he has to take care of the Ragnaros. He doesn't have an option. He's just going to single-handedly lose that card if he doesn't check it. Pinging on the Twilight Drake, I'm sorry, on the Azure Drake, is something else he has to do. If he just played Archmage Antonitis into it, Lifecoach would have to check what's on the board, and he's getting free initiative. Lothar just really needs Lifecoach's hand to be nothing, but it's so close to impossible for that to be the case, but it's still probably his best way to win.
Yeah, I like this play a lot. The Lothar just really checks out the Archmage Antonitis, and the only two ways to come back in this game are basically the Dr. Boom and the Archmage Antonitis, so you want to check as many of those as possible.
Spare part not going to matter this turn, and Lifecoach is looking primed to take this game right here. 9, 10, 11, plus 6. He's got 17 damage, so if he checks his counterspell with a spare part or with Wrath first, he's going to win this game right here. So there's the armor plating to check against that counter spell, and Force of Nature is going to finish this off. Lifecoach has a 3-0 lead and has 4 games to win a single game with his comfort deck, Handlock.
Oh, man. Lothar came into it, I'm sure, somewhat confident since he had already beaten one of his teammates, but now Lifecoach is just being a huge hurdle for him right now. Lifecoach has had a 3-0 lead right now, and he's left with Handlock, as you said, and Handlock, again, Lifecoach's most signature deck and the deck that I would say he's best with right now. Lothar has some decks that he can use to defeat the Handlock. He has the Facehunter, obviously, but just winning 4 games against Lifecoach's Handlock, how easy can that be?
It's going to be so tough because even, let's just say that Lifecoach only had a 30% chance to win every single one of these games. Even with that being the case, it's still something like he's still got over a 50% chance to win the match when he's only got 30% chance to win each singular game. And that's such a hurdle to have to overcome. It's the biggest disadvantage basically you can be at. But I got a feel for Lothar in this. His draws in this match have been pretty close to abysmal.
Yeah, I have to say that there actually might be a potential for Handlock to lose 4 games in a row. We have seen a precedent for that, actually. For example, in the Root tournament, Teray played Handlock 4 times in a row against his opponent. I think it might have actually just been Lifecoach. So in Teray versus Lifecoach, where Teray played Handlock every single game, he actually lost 4-0. And as we know, Teray is also a very great Handlock player. So Lifecoach, there's still hope for Lothar, is what I'm saying. There's still hope for Lothar and his wizard cone right now.
Definitely an uphill battle and needs to get work done. So I gotta believe he really wants to get a win on the board right now. I'm saying he's gonna go face center against this Warlock deck.
I think he needs that confidence back, and I think if he wants to win this tournament, he needs to queue up with the deck he's most confident with. And I think I gotta believe the Face Hunter is the deck. It just has so much burst, so many ways to kill the Handlock straight away. And he's definitely not going to be wanting to go down 4-0. It's his first tournament finals, and going down 4-0 would just be so disheartening.
Not the position he wants to be in, for sure. So this game is getting loaded up. Game 4 of the grand finals of Kinguin for Charity number 3. Lifecoach is on match point, and Lothar is indeed going to be going with Hunter here. Look at that death stare he has. He wants blood. He smells it.
Mm-hmm. Iron Beak Owl is kind of half of the infamous Iron Beak Owl Ancient Watcher combo that you can use to contest the board. Sludge Belcher is also another key card. Sun Fury Protector, also great to taunt up minions, but some of these cards, you might just want to chuck them later on.
I certainly think so. Something else, though, that I think he's going to take into account is the importance of something like Mortal Coil in a matchup like this. He wants to check Leopard Gnomes, he wants to check Abusive Sergeants, and potentially even check Wolf Riders with it. So to see him mulligan this full hand wouldn't be a big surprise, but to see him hang on the Iron Beak Owl to make sure he gets something like Mad Scientist checked straight away, I think that's okay too, because he wants Lothar to be drawing Explosive Trap. He wants Lothar to draw Misdirections. He doesn't want them to get him on the board for free, especially the fact that if he couples that with an Eagle Horn Bow, that's really where he sees a lot of win rate, is when Lifecoach is forced to check a trap and Lothar gets extra mileage out of the weapon.
Now, we have to also note that Lifecoach, as we've seen in his previous Handlock games, is running at least one Zombie Chow. So this is actually very interesting. Like, he kept the Sun Fairy and he kept the Sludge Belcher. I would think that with at least one Zombie Chow in his deck and two Mortal Coils, he would be more willing to chuck away more of the high cost minions like the Sludge Belcher. But instead, he actually keeps the Sun Fairy and the Sludge Belcher, and it even throws away the Iron Beak Owl.
Yeah, so I think it's okay to go ahead and keep Sludge Belcher here. It kind of consistent with the way that he's been playing. Is he's keeping mad cards that he feels like are very key to winning the match. And Sludge Belcher is certainly one of them. Ancient Watcher is going to come down. Sunfury Protector, I also think, is another one, too. There's a lot of potential, I think, to just play it on turn two and start getting some work done. But when he draws Ancient Watcher, it's like perfect. It's going to soak up so much damage and make sure it forces Lothar to be putting damage into an otherwise fairly useless minion. So when he makes Misha here, I think it's great for him. Simply because now he has a really easy check to this Ancient Watcher if it gets taunted. And at the same time, this Knife Juggler didn't get checked. Wow, Lothar just throws out a well-played already. But, oh my gosh, Ancient Watcher. I actually didn't see the Shadow Flame in his hand, so Ancient Watcher is actually just going to be a really, really heavy turn here. And Lothar, you see him roll his eyes and take a deep breath. Lifecoach, wow, this is looking great for him. Second Unleash the Hounds gets drawn for Lothar. He just has no action other than this Arcane. Is he just going to jam Arcane Golem down? I think he's got to do it.
Arcane Golem, give your opponent 5 mana, let him play Sludge Belcher, right? Then the Sludge Belcher keep would look genius.
You know, it's going to get Iron Beak Owl, though. But then he can just re-taunt it with the Sun Fairy Protector. Oh, I think he's got to go Arcane Golem. I think he needs his damage.
Yeah, I think all the other cards are just not impactful enough.
Oh, he's going to go for it. Here's your Wild Growth, he says. 4 damage to the face, and Lifecoach, like, eh, okay, that's fine. Yeah, I got a Sludge Belcher for that. Shrugging it off, not a big deal for him. But you gotta feel some pressure when your opponent just jams on Arcane Golem, and I think he's about to feel a lot more pressure here. Wolf Rider gets added to Lothar's hand. The pressure is building for him. 4 more damage to face. Is he gonna Hero Power? Is he gonna Wolf Rider? I like it. Jam it into his face and let him figure it out. Lothar says, if you have Molten Giants, I don't care. Lifecoach has a second Sun Fury Protector so he can taunt up his board. Oh my gosh! This game is getting so crazy. If Lothar draws Kill Commands, this game is going to end.
And even if he throws down both Sun Fury Protectors on the board, that activates Unleash the Hounds. So we saw a great Shadow Flame plus Ancient Watcher from Lifecoach, but it just might not be enough. Whatever Lothar is keeping in his hand, the Arcane Golem just is going to go straight to the face, and the taunts just might not be enough. He also doesn't have anti-heal bots. He doesn't have really great forms of healing. I mean, Siphon Soul could be a play, but if you're going to Siphon Soul a minion heal for 3, that's just not enough either. What can Lifecoach do?
I think Siphon Soul is probably one of his better plays. Lifecoach is going to life tap. What on earth?
Oh, man.
I thought for sure he was going to Siphon Soul this Arcane Golem and attack the Wolf Rider.
I think Lifecoach is thinking, I just really have to get to my anti-heal bots as soon as possible. I need healing right away. We saw Lifecoach in previous games against the Beats, for example. He tapped more than many other players would, and what that meant was he got to his Big Game Hunter one turn earlier than many other players would have, and he got the Big Game Hunter at exactly the right time to counter Sabitz's Dr. Gloom, and that meant all the difference.
Yep, it certainly did. He's going to choose to attack this Arcane Golem here and enforce some sort of inefficient attacks. Lothar picks up Misdirection, which isn't the greatest play right now. So Unleash the Hound's going to be coming out, and a little bit more damage is going to be for it. Actually, is Double Unleash the Hounds reasonable here? So if he unleashes here, he's got 5 minions on the board. I actually like attacking one of these minions in and then playing Unleash the Hounds again. Is that going to be enough? 1, 2, 3. He'll have 3 more after that, and then one there. So hang on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. He'll have 7 damage potentially to face this turn. I think you go for it.
Yeah, so, I like it as well.
So put 1 Unleash the Hound token into Sun Fury Protector here. Cast your second Unleash the Hounds. Put either Iron Beak Owl or 2 more tokens into the Sun Fury Protector. This works as well, just to make sure that you have tokens on here. And then just, so go ahead and put these 1-1 dogs into these and then put 7 points of damage to face. Life Coach is going to fall to 1 life and Lothar is at 30. I don't see any way that Life Coach is pulling this game out.
Yeah, basically Life Coach, he needs an anti-kill bot, but even if he gets an anti-kill bot, both Sun Fairy Protectors have been used. So there's no way to actually taunt up and heal on this very same turn.
Yep. So I don't see anything. He's going to take his time and make sure there's nothing here, but he's going to get the bad news. Just hero power is so much more than enough right now. It's 200% of his life total and damage. And Lothar, you can see he's looking on with intensity. He wants to win this game. He needs a point on the board. And I think this is his time to do it.
I think the play here is just Hellfire. Give your teammate the win and move on to the next game. You've still got 3 chances to win with your hand luck, so why not?
He's going to Siphon Soul, going to run into Ironbeak Owl. It's not going to be enough. Still 4 points of damage available for Lothar. And he's going to let him get his blood, even Kill Command, just in case it wasn't enough. Lothar going to get his first point on the board. 3-1 Life Coach right now. Life Coach still on match point. He's got 3 more games to win with Handlock, but it's got to feel good if you're Lothar right now to get a game under your belt.
Yeah, just moving on forward, I think Lothar, he needs to just keep queuing up decks that he thinks are favorable against the Handlock. Just keep building that confidence up, because without the confidence, I don't think Lothar can defeat Life Coach. Life Coach has taken a 3-0 lead, and so Lothar must be down in the dumps. But with this one win, Lothar still has a chance to come back into it.
Yeah, it certainly does. And but he's still got a long way to go, though. 3 more games have to be won. He's got Mage, he's got Druid, and he's got Rogue to go ahead and take care of this. So this game's going to be getting started up in just a moment here. Again, Life Coach, you know, I still would have liked to see him use Siphon Soul on that Arcane Golem that turn. If he had used Siphon Soul, he would have gone up to 13 points of life. He could have attacked Ironbeak Owl with Sludge Belcher, and then he would have found himself in a position where he has Sludge Belcher on the board as a 3-3 versus an opponent's Wolf Rider, and he's at 13 HP. As opposed to the way he played it in this situation, where he kind of left himself a little bit vulnerable to Unleash the Hounds. Obviously, he's not accounting for 2 copies of Unleash the Hounds, but he's still got to get something done for it. So Game 5 is going to be underway. Life Coach versus Lothar. 1 more game needed again for Life Coach to win this series. Lothar's going to go with Mage. Key cards in this opening hand. Lothar obviously wants to get a very strong curve coming into it. So like Cogmaster, Mad Scientists, Mech Warpers, that sort of thing. And Life Coach, he's going to be looking... He's one of these players that kind of mulligans very differently than almost everyone we've seen. He's keeping Molten Giant in his opening hand in this situation. I like that he's kept Ancient Watcher. This is going to help him get Sun Fury or Ironbeak Owl to activate it. But Molten Giant is kind of a peculiar keep. I like that he's keeping it in this aggro matchup because it means he's hunting for big swing turns and he understands the importance of that card in this matchup. So Zombie Chow's going to get drawn on turn 1. Not too shabby. And I feel like Handlock also does a pretty good job at checking against Mech Mage because it's got Zombie Chow and it's got Ancient Watcher to check against Mirror Entity Secrets.
All right, Admiral, here I am back into the game. And I see Life Coach has a pretty good start right now with the Zombie Chow on turn 1.
Yeah, he kept this Molten Giant in his opening hand, by the way. He didn't just draw into that. He actually chose to keep it. So it picks up a second Molten Giant here. Spider Tank got developed. So not too much action going on. Zombie Chow has not been able to buy very much value. Just went ahead and coined out Spider Tank to contest what's going on the board. And now really no action available. I would venture to say he's going to play Mech Warper and a Noyatron. But then he's got the question of whether or not he attacks Spider Tank.
All right, there's a pretty clean trade for Spider Tech right now, 3-4 into the 2-3.
Yeah, I don't know if he's actually going to trade or not. Like, Annoyatron's going to be able to fend off attacks. Like, does he need to favor trading right now? Because one of the things he doesn't want to happen is he doesn't want to be vulnerable to Hellfire either. Yeah, I think I like going for face.
All
Mortal Coil's not the greatest right now. So Ancient Watcher is going to be the play. Goes in, life taps. And not too much action from him otherwise. He's got two Mountain Giants in his hand now, though. So in the hunt for a big swing turn. I got to feel like this is a Goblin Blast Mage turn, but you have to be so afraid of Shadow Flame. He got almost blown out by Shadow Flame last game. That's not what he wants to happen again. Take his time. Figure out the math. You can tell that this Ancient Watcher is putting a lot of pressure on Lothar right now. He feels like he wants to kill it and prevent something like a big Shadow Flame or from this being taunted or even silenced to contest this board position. Two very different lines. Pile of Destroyer is also not like a bad option. I like going with the Goblin Blast Mage though. Roll some dice, see what ends up happening here. Wow, so he gets such good hits on this. Oh my gosh, is he choosing to... He chooses to not take out this Ancient Watcher, and he opens himself up to Shadow Flame and Life Coach top decks Shadow Flame. And he's going to be able to clear this board position. Oh my gosh. That is so bad for Lothar right now. A completely clear board, and you can see him. He's smiling about it, but he saw it was off on the right side of his hand. That's got to feel bad. And Life Coach just, wow, look, he's just almost in bewilderment. I can't believe he drew that Shadow Flame. So this is certainly going to be a Piloted Shredder and a Cogmaster here from Lothar. His opponent's still not in Molten Giant range, though. If he chooses to save this Mirror Entity going into a Molten Giant turn, that could be a little bit problematic for Life Coach. It feels like he wants to play Mirror Entity now, though. Almost like he's fearing something. Yeah, I would tend to favor the Cogmaster and the Piloted Shredder here. There's no reason to play the Goblin Blast Mage. You can't get value out of its battle cry right now. So turn six for Life Coach. Picks up Antique Healbot. But he's got to feel pressure. He's got to feel like he needs something on the board. So it looks to me like it's going to be a Sludge Belcher turn. If he chooses to play something like Sylvanas, he's going to be dead to Fireball. There's 7 points of damage on Lothar's side of the board, and I don't think he wants to drop that low. So Sludge Belcher definitely going to be the play. Definitely a strong counter to Piloted Shredder as well. A small problem here with that is actually how this attack ends up working out, because I think Lothar wants to try to avoid any risks he can, but it's going to be necessary for him to take one. So I suspect Piloted Shredder is going to be running into Sludge Belcher, and that's going to be followed by Snow Chugger and Goblin Blast Mage to try to finish things off. There's a chance that this Goblin Blast Mage would backfire. And if it backfires, that'd spell really bad news for Lothar in a situation like this. Like, say 4 points of damage went to face instead. It's going to activate Molten Giants. So something he wants to be wary of. Gets an Annoyatron out of his Piloted Shredder, so he gets to keep his mech on the board. I think now this is going to be the turn where Lothar develops Mirror Entity. Yeah, that's exactly what he's going to do. That's actually a lot of pressure on the Life Coach right now, because he's sitting at 15 life. He doesn't have a big swing turn for Molten Giants. But which one of these minions does he play? Which one is safest? Even if you give your opponent something like Big Game Hunter, they're still getting a 4-power minion on board. So Mortal Coil going to be the first order of business. Pick up some extra options here. It's not a big threat, but it's a threat nonetheless.
So many possibilities.
Gosh, if that Mirror Entity wasn't here, Life Coach had so many good turns. Alas.
Out of time.
How do you play right against this? He doesn't want to lose all the ground that he's so close to having with his Molten Giants. He kept Molten Giant in his hand specifically to get Swing Turn. So if he uses something like Antique Healbot to trigger this Mirror Entity, he's putting himself out of range of having these Molten Giant Swing Turns. But frankly, I think his hand might have enough action to be able to play around that anyway. Like, he's up to 23, he's not facing a ton of damage, Lothar is down to 4 cards, and he's got Hellfire in his hand to help clear up what's happening. So I actually feel like going for 4 points of damage, go to face from this Goblin Blast Mage, and Lothar looks like he's facepalming from that, as if he wanted some extra damage here. So I don't mind some of the trade, I wouldn't mind trading here, but at the same time, I think he's got a favor at some point going for face. So I think he should be putting 4 damage to face here and going with Snowchucker and trying to move forward. Oh, he's going to Frostbolt this Anti-Killbot. I really don't like this. That's part of the reach that he needs to be able to end this game. He doesn't have Fireball right now. And it looks like Monk has joined us again. Welcome back, Monk.
Thanks. Good to be back. And as I can see, Lifecoach is almost stabilized on this board against Mech Mage. And it looks like we saw the Frostbolt coming down. I guess he wanted to play around Shadowflame. But at this point, it means there's no more burn in Lothar's hand.
Yeah, having used a Frostbolt here is really kind of rough. But you have to consider, like, say he chose to trade Anti-Healbot in instead of using Frostbolt. What he's effectively doing is he's turning his Anti-Healbot on the board into a Frostbolt in his hand. And that's probably a little bit worse than keeping Anti-Healbot on the board. Like, he has seen a Shadowflame already. And Hellfire is not like the worst card in the world for him because he's still going to have the 5/4 on board afterwards. So I don't think he's like too afraid of what's going on.
Lifecoach seems to be looking all over his hand. He's just at barely the point where he can't play a Molten plus an Argus. He really wishes that Argus were a Sun Fury right now.
Yep.
And I think right now he can probably consider just Siphon Souling. But the problem with Siphon Soul is it brings him even closer out of Molten Giant range, so he has to rely on his opponent actually hitting him on the next turn.
It's kind of scary though, like if he chooses to just let his opponent hit him with the extra 5 added in, he's just dead to Fireball, and I think that's the situation he's trying to avoid. Oh, and the full board's going to get loaded up. Is he going to hold on to Snowchugger?
I'm not sure I like that. I think you need to go just basically all in right now. There's not many ways for you to win. Like, let's say the board does get cleared right now and you still have a Snowchugger in your hand. What's that really going to do, right?
I think I would tend to agree with you. He is going to get a little bit rewarded for his play, though. So two... And when I say a little bit rewarded, I do mean a little bit rewarded, because now it's 2 Molten Giants hitting the board. And I imagine these are probably going to get taunted up. One of the only ways Lifecoach can lose right now is to some sort of attack shenanigans, like maybe like a, say like Whirling Blades and Fireball. There's the other Frostbolt from Lothar. If Lothar picks up a Fireball, this game could end.
Yeah, so I think right now he has to go ping face, I guess.
Yeah.
He has to hope his opponent doesn't have anything else. And like, basically these taunts are so big that there's no hope for him ever getting past them for the entirety of the game.
You know what? Lifecoach has an opportunity for lethal this turn as well. No, he doesn't. He's got the Noitron on the board. I lied to you. 17 plus 8. Yeah, 17 plus 8 is not going to be enough for that. I just was ignoring the Noitron. I was like, he can just put all this damage to face and drop Ragnaros. So Lifecoach, he does not have a way to play around Fireball right now, and I don't think he should put himself in singular Fireball range by life tapping. So I think it's just going to be something like Sludge Belcher or Ragnaros, and then everything else to face. You can see him really heavily considering taking out this Snowchugger.
Yeah, I think the risk versus reward is just not there for tapping. Whereas if you play Ragnaros or Sludge Belcher, they're almost equivalent plays because you have enough taunts already. But you're setting up lethal anyway with Sludge Belcher or with Ragnaros.
Ragnaros hits the board, and it's match point for Lifecoach right now. And you can tell him, oh, he's torn up about attacking this Snowchugger or not. Is it really? The reason he's doing it is he's thinking about Goblin Blast Mage. Like, if Goblin Blast Mage hits him 2 or 3 times and then a Fireball happens, Honestly, I think he should attack it. He's going to go for face, though. So favoring damage on the face is Life Coach. I think it's going to be pretty inconsequential. It is fireball or bust for Lothar. It's not going to be it, and Life Coach is going to win this series 4-1 and pick up his first championship, winning Kinguin for charity, number 3. Frostbolt to his own face, and that's going to do it. Wow, what a...